Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 27th May 2019. The list of articles chosen for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, and Thiruvananthapuram editions, are provided here. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on to our first article analysis. The discussion based on this article will be relevant under current events of national importance, then in social development and also in social sector initiatives. The discussion is also relevant in GS paper 2 under the area government policies and interventions for development in various sectors, then also in issues relating to development and management of social sector relating to education. The news article talks about the first 100 days agenda of the second term of the NDA government. And one of the key purposes in the first 100 days agenda is that all central universities have been asked to notify their faculty vacancies, and that is too within the next 100 days. It is to be noted that currently over 5,000 posts remain vacant in the 40 central universities. The vacancy situation was already aggravated by legal battles over how to implement reservations in faculty hiring. Additionally, in a controversial ruling in April 2017, the Allahabad High Court struck down the existing system. The existing system mandated determining reservations for the university as a whole and not for separate departments. So, after the struck down of this system, in March 2018, the University Grants Commission directed institutions to start treating each department as a separate unit in their recruitment process. But in many smaller departments, this resulted in few or no faculty reservations and led to outrage, especially among Dalit and Adivasi communities. Then the government issued an ordinance in March 2019 to revert to the older system of reservation. These court battles led to the halt in recruitment and in turn increased the vacancy. Now, next on the first 100 days agenda list is a proposal to get cabinet approval for 10 more institutes of eminence. This is expected to incur an additional cost of 7,000 crore rupees. Note that 11 institutions were recommended under this scheme in 2018 by the Empowered Expert Committee, headed by former Chief Election Commissioner. But the centre finally bestowed or gave the institutions of eminence tag to only 6 institutions. The news article also states other items on the 100-day action plan, like the long-delayed national education policy. The national education policy will be discussed when the policy will be implemented by the government. So today, let's understand about the institutions of eminence scheme. First, know that eminence means greatness and prestige. So you can get an overall view of what institutions of eminence is from the name itself. The Institutions of Eminence scheme was launched in order to implement the commitment of the government to empower the higher educational institutions and to help them become world-class teaching and research institutions. Under this scheme, 10 public and 10 private institutions are to be identified to emerge as world-class teaching and research institutions. This is to enhance affordable access to high-quality education for ordinary Indians. So, the University Grants Commission or UGC issued an enabling regulatory architecture for the implementation of the scheme. And in order to realize the goal, the Ministry of Human Resource Development and the UGC evolved the policy that was incorporated in the UGC Declaration of Government Educational Institutions as Institutions of Eminence Guidelines 2017 and also in UGC Institutions of Eminence deemed to be universities regulations 2017. These guidelines and regulations were issued to enable 10 public and 10 private institutions to emerge as world-class teaching and research institutions. And these institutions are called as Institutions of Eminence, or in short, IOEs. The aim of the scheme is to bring higher educational institutions selected as IOEs in top 500 of world ranking. That is to in next 10 years. Then after some time, the aim will be to bring these IOEs to top 100 of world rankings. As we saw, the scheme was launched with an objective to provide world-class teaching and research facilities to Indian students within the country and enhance general level of education of the country. The salient features of the scheme include greater autonomy, specifically to admit foreign students up to 30% of admitted domestic students. Then also to recruit foreign faculty up to 25% of faculty strength. Then to offer online courses up to 20% of institutions programs. Then the scheme allows the IOEs to enter into academic collaboration with top 500 world ranking institutions without the permission of UGC. Next, it also allows to fix the fees by the IOEs and charge fees from foreign students without restriction. Then there is also flexibility to frame course structure in terms of number of credit hours and number of years to take a degree. And this in turn gives complete flexibility in fixing of curriculum and syllabus to the IOEs. So under this scheme, IOEs will have freedom to choose their own path to become world-class institutions. Each public institution selected as IOE will be provided financial assistance of up to rupees 1000 crore over a period of 5 years. This fund is meant for research activities and it should be available for all educational institutions and their faculty, thus creating a healthy competition among the institutions and giving a fillip or boost to the research activities. Then it will also lead to better research output and international rankings. The institutions will be selected as IOEs by the Empowered Expert Committee, which was constituted for the selection purpose. The Empowered Expert Committee will monitor and review their implementation plans of the institutions which have applied for IOE status. So, in 2018, the committee recommended 8 public institutions and 3 private institutions for the IOE status. Then on UGC's recommendation, 3 public and 3 private institutions were approved by the government as IOEs. They are first Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, Karnataka, then Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, Maharashtra, and Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, under public sector category. Then also Geo Institute of Reliance Foundation, Pune, under the Greenfield category. Next, Birla Institute of Technology and Sciences, that is BITS Pilani, Rajasthan. Then finally, Manipal Academy of Higher Education, present in Manipal in Karnataka, under the private sector category. Here, note that the Greenfield category means the institution has not yet been established. It is a separate category where the sponsoring organizations will set up new institutions. So here the Geo Institute will be set up by the Reliance Foundation. UGC requested the EEC to continue its process till all the 20 institutions are identified. So in its second report, EEC recommended additionally 2 institutions in the public category and 7 in the private category. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next news article, which is about the solar and wind energy sector. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in your prelims syllabus under current events of national and international importance and also in economic development. The discussion will also be relevant in main syllabus under GS paper 2 in government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation. Then also in GS paper 3 under energy in infrastructure. The news article is about the solar and wind energy sector in the renewable energy sector. Note that with respect to renewable energy sector, the government has set a target of installing 175 gigawatts of renewable energy capacity by the year 2022, which includes 100 gigawatts from solar, 60 gigawatts from wind, 10 gigawatts from biopower, and 5 gigawatts from small hydropower. The article states that the target for solar energy was set 5 times more than the target set by the then government in 2009. Note that in 2009, the government of India launched the National Solar Mission with the target of grid-connected solar projects of 20,000 megawatt by 2022, which is only 20 gigawatts. But in 2015, this target was increased or revised by 5 times to achieve 1 lakh megawatts, that is 100 gigawatts by 2022. The objective of this national solar mission was to establish India as a global leader in solar energy by creating the policy conditions for the diffusion of solar energy or spreading solar energy widely across the country as quickly as possible. Now, the author of this article has given the issues in meeting these targets for solar energy and wind energy. With respect to solar, the domestic manufacturers of solar modules have suffered because of cheaper imports or dumping of imports from China, Malaysia, Taiwan, US, Saudi Arabia and Thailand. Against this dumping, there were requests of imposing anti-dumping duty since 2014, and the Ministry of Commerce has also recommended the anti-dumping duties to save the domestic manufacturers. But only by the end of March 2019, that is some 1.5 months before, the government has imposed anti-dumping duties on ethylene vinyl acetate sheet, which are used for solar cells and which were imported from China, Malaysia, Saudi Arabia and Thailand. This anti-dumping duty is for a period of 5 years. Here, the author is pointing out the 5-year delay in imposing this duty, that is from 2014 to 2019. In addition to this delay, the GST rates and depreciation has also affected the solar sector. Also, the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy has lowered the power tariff for wind and solar energy. But the author states that this has been helpful only to electricity distribution companies and not to the customers, and was not helpful to the manufacturers also. Now, the problem here is, if it is not profitable for manufacturers, developers will not come forward. If it is not helpful for the customers, then after some time there will be fallen demand also. Next, with respect to wind energy, the author has highlighted one problem, that is the procedures with respect to land acquisition for wind power generation. This was referred by the author as land problems, and this was seen mainly in the state of Gujarat. Many developers are choosing Gujarat to establish wind power capacities because of the wind energy generation potential of the state. Even all developers of wind energy going to one state is not a healthier development. Hence, the industry related to wind energy has asked the government to intervene in the process and to promote an even development across the states. But so far, no efforts had been taken to manage this problem of uneven development. Next, with respect to awarding the contracts to the projects, the government has adopted auctions as a method to grant the wind projects. But the industrial players demand a process with closed tender. In auctions, the bidders try to outbid each other to get the project sometimes. And in auctions, they even do not weigh in the cost-benefit analysis and may bid for even unhealthier terms just to get the project, even if it compromises the profit. But in a closed tender, this cannot happen, and there is possibility that the project may go in to better manufacturing companies. And moreover, profit realization is also comparatively good in closed tenders with respect to holding auctions. Further, the chairman of Indian Wind Turbine Manufacturers Association has said that in all other sectors such as railways or defense, the auctions are not held for awarding contracts. Rather, it is always a closed tender. Now, here we have to note that there is also rampant corruption in these processes. And after securing a project in a state, the state government owned companies get the services from these energy companies and have been delaying in paying their dues to the energy companies. All these amounts to huge strain on the part of the energy companies, and the government has made no effort to address these issues, and all these affects the new capacity addition to achieve the targets. Now, in wind energy, the government is now focusing also on offshore wind projects and has fixed a target to achieve 5 gigawatts for 2022 and 30 gigawatts for 2030 for offshore wind energy capacity. When we say offshore wind, it means wind that moves off the shore or off the land, that is wind moving from the land to the sea. Even here, the tender has not come yet. Regarding other sectors of renewable energy, the author states that the emerging areas in renewable energy are ocean energy and geothermal energy. If the government shows solid commitment by having a long-term vision in these areas, then India could leapfrog and lead the world in these sectors. The ocean energy is currently promising and can give energy for 24 hours a day for all years. Ocean energy means energy generated through oceanic waves, tides and ocean currents. A research study by CRISIL and IIT Madras with respect to ocean energy has recommended for a strong government support in the beginning. But there has been no credible response from the government towards this meaningful recommendation. Once ocean energy generation will be expensive in the beginning, and therefore the author talks about the support from the government. Next, with respect to biomass and small hydropower, the author says they are in high declining stage and government should take necessary measures to tap the potential in these areas. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article, which is about the purpose of journalism. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in prelims preparation under current events of national importance. And it will also be relevant in your mains preparation under GS Paper 2 in the area important aspects of governance, transparency and accountability. In this entire editorial, the author stresses the fact that the fundamentals and purpose of journalism should remain the same, irrespective of the electoral outcomes, and the freedom of press should be upheld. Now, we have split this editorial into three parts. In the first part, we will be seeing the present concerns of press that is listed by the author. And in the second part, we will be discussing the principles, purpose and fundamentals of journalism that is also discussed by the author. And in the final part, we will be seeing some suggestions given by the author to uphold the freedom of press. Let us see the first part now. The author enlists some of the incidents that happened in the last 5 years of NDA government. And some of the indices and rankings about the freedom of press in India is also mentioned by the author. The author has noted that there is a very disturbing retreat in the information and the media sphere. Here, the author indirectly intends to tell that the information provided by the press is misguided or biased. The author then discusses elaborately about the World Press Freedom Index for the year 2019. Now, know that this index is released by the Reporters Without Borders. Its original name in French is Reporters Sans Frontières. Hence, it is mentioned as RSF in brackets in this editorial. This Reporters Without Borders is an international non-profit, non-governmental organization based in Paris. And it conducts political advocacy on issues relating to freedom of information and freedom of the press. Here in this editorial, the author has also mentioned some points from the report. This report has documented that how hatred of journalists has degenerated into violence, contributing to an increase in fear around the world. The report also tells that there is a steady decline in the number of countries regarded as safe, where journalists can work in complete security, and that the authoritarian regimes or governments continue to tighten their grip on the media. The index has also downgraded India by 2 ranks, that is from 138 to 140, because of 2 reasons. One is 6 journalists were murdered in 2018, and the other is critics of Hindu nationalism were branded as anti-Indians in online harassment campaigns. Now, more information about this Press Freedom Index has been discussed in our previous session on 23rd April 2019. Check the link given in the description box to add on to this content. It will be helpful in answering the practice mains question that we have given along with this discussion. The author has also discussed one more index in the later part of this editorial. This index is named as Global Impunity Index. Here, impunity means freedom from the punishment that is to be given. So, we know that at least 6 journalists were murdered in the year 2018 in India. But still, majority of the murderers are not traceable, which means they still roam in freedom without any punishment. Now, this creates fear among the journalists to practice their profession. For almost a decade, India continues to be under this global impunity index. Know that all the countries are not ranked in this index. Only those countries with high impunity cases are listed and ranked in this index. So, Global Impunity Index for the year 2018 has listed 14 countries in this index, and India is ranked 14th out of 14 countries listed in the index. Now, let us see the second part of the editorial. Here, first the author describes about the principles and the purpose of journalism. The author has quoted a textbook on journalism which is titled The Elements of Journalism. According to the authors of this textbook, the purpose of journalism is not defined by technology, neither by journalists, nor even by the techniques they employ. But the principles and purpose of journalism are defined by something more basic, that is, the function that news plays in the lives of people. The purpose of journalism is to provide citizens with the information they need to make the best possible decisions about their life, their communities, their societies, and their governments. Next, the author has listed out the fundamentals of journalism. Media scholars have identified two major functions for the news media. One, the credible informational function, and then the critical analytical investigative function. Here, credible informational is the ready-made information that is available to the journalists. The author notes that the present political environment in India is not hostile. Here you should see the choice of words that the author has used. The author could have used the word favorable political environment, but he has clearly used not hostile, which means it is not that unfriendly. Next, as the name suggests, critical analytical investigative type of journalism needs the journalist to be active and also to do some groundwork in order to gather the news. Now, this is where the journalists face innumerable threats to their profession and also to their life. The author tells that there is an intimidating or a threatening environment to the journalists at present in India. He quotes some legal terms like SLAP, which is a strategic lawsuit against public participation. Next, criminal defamation laws, and also mentions that there is a denial of access to crucial information from the government sites. Here, SLAP's aim is to shut down critical speech by intimidating critics into silence and draining their resources. And finally, the author notes that when the journalists try to hold those individuals in power, these individuals are deploying many ways to weaken the journalists' efforts. This includes from threatening the journalists to killing them. The author, before mentioning the purpose of journalism, has discussed an interesting quote. He tells that there is an often conflicting demand between what is in public interest and what the public is interested in. If you see, at many instances, the journalists gather information in the name of public interest, but it might not actually be the case. The public was actually interested to know. In the third part of the editorial, the author has put forward a list of what we as citizens expect from the media in general, and what the media in particular, the Hindu, expects during the Prime Minister's second term of government. The author states that the Prime Minister during his first term may have developed a direct communication channel with the people through his social media handles like Twitter, Facebook, etc. and also through his periodic broadcast Mann Ki Baat. The author notes that this direct communication has yielded political advantages to the PM. But the author also stresses, as the head of the largest democracy in the world, the PM and his government needs to constantly interact with the larger news media and not some select players alone. Also, he has said that an open press conference in which unscripted questions are encouraged would be a positive development. Next, the author tells that salient features of the Right to Information Act must be strengthened so that the proper and time-bound information is made available. The author has also given some suggestion to how journalists should work irrespective of whoever is in power. He tells that the journalists should not be apologetic or regretful, but instead regain their sense of pride. This should be done by asking probing or investigative questions, and such questions should demand accountability, should be framed in a way to seek answers, and the journalist should always speak the truth. All this will not only serve the purpose of journalism, but all these will also ensure that journalism survives as a discipline. With this, we have come to the end of this analysis. The displayed practice prelims and mains question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article, which is about the minimum support price. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in prelims syllabus under the area current events of national importance and in economic and social development, and also under sustainable development. The discussion is also relevant under GS paper 2 in the area government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation. Next, in welfare schemes for vulnerable sections of the population by the center and states and the performance of these schemes. Next, under GS paper 3, it is relevant in the area major crops, cropping patterns in various parts of the country, marketing of agricultural produce, and issues and related constraints. Next, also in issues related to direct and indirect farm subsidies and minimum support prices. The news article talks about the plan of Haryana government to discourage the planting of paddy or rice crops for the upcoming season. This is because paddy is a crop which requires more water for cultivation, and this threatens to deplete the state's groundwater. For this move of the government, the farmers have asked the government to first come out with a mechanism to procure alternative crops at the minimum support price, so that farmers are not at the disadvantaged end. Additionally, the farmers want the state government to enact a law which will guarantee the produce of farmer to be purchased only at the MSP. The state government is suggesting the cultivation of maize and tuvar pulse, that is in English pigeon peas and in Tamil tuvaram paruppu. So the Haryana government has decided to start a pilot project from May 27th. In this, sowing of maize and tuvar pulse would be promoted by giving incentives to farmers. This shows that the government intends to diversify from non-basmati paddy to maize and pulse. Under this new pilot scheme, farmers who are identified will be provided seeds free of cost and will be given a financial assistance of rupees 2000 per acre in two parts. Additionally, the maize produce will be procured by government agencies at MSP. Now, let us understand what is this MSP to completely understand this article. We know that the prices of agricultural commodities are inherently unstable, and this is primarily due to the variation in the supply of agricultural commodities, lack of market integration, and information asymmetry. So, a very good harvest in any year results in a sharp fall in the price of that commodity during that year, which in turn will have an adverse impact on the future supply of that commodity, as farmers will withdraw from sowing that crop in the next or following years. This then causes a scarcity of supply of that commodity the next year, and hence will lead to major price increase for consumers. To counter this, MSP or minimum support price for major agricultural products is fixed by the government each year. MSP is a tool which gives guarantee to the farmers prior to the sowing season that a fair amount of price is fixed to their upcoming crop. In other words, minimum support price is the price at which government purchases crops from the farmers. Minimum support price is an important part of India's agricultural price policy. This is to encourage higher investment and production of agricultural commodities. The MSP is in the nature of an assured market at a minimum guaranteed price that is offered by the government. The MSP helps to incentivize the farmers and thus ensures adequate food grains production in the country. It gives sufficient remuneration to the farmers, provides food grain supply to buffer stocks, and supports the food security program through PDS or public distribution system and other programs. The MSP is fixed on the recommendations of the Commission for Agricultural Costs and Prices, or in short, CACP. The CACP is a statutory body and submits separate reports recommending prices of Kharif and Rabi seasons. The central government, after considering the report and considering the views of the state governments, then also keeping in the view the overall demand and supply situation in the country, takes the final decision. Now, in the case of sugarcane, MSP has been assigned a statutory status, and so the announced price is termed as statutory minimum price, which was rechristened or renamed as fair remunerative price. So keep in mind that the fair remunerative price is for sugarcane. Note that there is a statutory binding on sugar factories to pay the minimum announced price, and all those transactions or purchases at prices lower than the announced price are considered illegal. MSP for the different agricultural crops, namely food grains, oil seeds, fiber crops, sugar cane and tobacco, are announced by the government of India before their sowing seasons. This makes it possible for the farmer to have an idea about the extent of price insurance cover provided by the government for the crop. The number of crops covered by MSP scheme has now increased to 24. So at present, the MSP covers 24 crops, that includes 7 cereals, that is paddy, wheat, barley, jowar, bajra, maize and ragi, and then 5 pulses, namely gram, arhar or tur, moong, urad and lentils, then 8 oil seeds such as groundnut, rapeseed or mustard, toria, soybean, sunflower seed, sesame, safflower seed and niger seed. Then other commercial crops such as copra, raw cotton, raw jute and Virginia flue cured tobacco. With this, we have come to the end of this analysis. The mains question displayed here is a previously asked question in the year 2018 in GS paper 3. This has been provided for the benefit of the students. Have a look at it. Moving on to the last article for the day, which is about the National Green Tribunal asking the Central Pollution Control Board to exercise its statutory powers. The article discussion will be helpful under prelim syllabus in the area Indian Polity and Governance, and the analysis will also be helpful in mains in General Studies paper 3 under the area Statutory, Regulatory and various quasi judicial bodies, and the discussion can also be linked to the area Environmental Pollution in General Studies paper 3. The news article has stated that the National Green Tribunal has asked the Central Pollution Control Board to exercise the statutory power it has under various legislations. Here the word statute means law. So statutory power means the power that is derived from the legal provisions, such as from certain sections or provisions in an act of parliament. The NGT has asked to exercise these powers against a private developer who was alleged to have committed environmental violations such as encroachment on green areas and illegal extraction of groundwater. Green areas here refer to agricultural land or those lands that was declared by the appropriate authority in the government as not to be utilized for construction and other activities that are detrimental or harmful to the environment. Earlier, the NGT has constituted a committee to look into the various allegations, and the committee has also submitted its report to the NGT. The committee also had representatives from CPCB. Despite the report submission, no action has been taken by CPCB on the private developer. In the report, the CPCB has stated that the project proponent or the developer has to give the action plan. Also, it maintained that for the illegal extraction of groundwater, the Central Groundwater Authority has to determine the compensation. For this submission by the Central Pollution Control Board, the NGT has stated that already the CPCB has powers in the legislation such as the Water Act of 1974 and the Air Act of 1981. The tribunal has asked the board to exercise these statutory powers to prosecute and take actions. Here the word prosecute means to start a trial and to pass sentence and punishment in judicial parlance. But in the context of this article, CPCB has to carry out inquiry and to pass appropriate penalties and punitive actions on the developer. Also, the CPCB is entitled to disconnect electricity and water supply and to take other measures for stopping the illegal activities of the developer. The developer has to abide by CPCB's orders. If it does not abide by the orders, the permission given to the developer shall be withdrawn. Now, in this context, let us discuss the National Green Tribunal and the Central Pollution Control Board in brief. There will be articles coming in the news in the following days. So, we will discuss about these institutions in deeper in the coming days. National Green Tribunal or NGT is a statutory body as it was established by the National Green Tribunal Act of 2010. The purpose of establishment of NGT was for the effective and speedy disposal of cases relating to environmental protection and forest conservation and also other natural resources. Here, cases may also be relating to enforcement of any legal right relating to environment. It also includes giving relief and compensation for damages caused to persons and property. It was established to provide speedy environmental justice and to help reduce the burden of litigation in environmental matters in higher courts. The tribunal is mandated to take necessary steps for speedy disposal of applications or appeals within 6 months of filing. The principal place of sitting of the tribunal is New Delhi. Now let us see about the Central Pollution Control Board or CPCB. CPCB is also a statutory body constituted under the Water Act of 1974. The CPCB has been entrusted with the powers and functions under the Air Act of 1981. And CPCB comes under the Ministry of Environment and Forests. On an overall picture, it has responsibility for prevention and control of water and air pollution under respective legislations such as Water Act and Air Act. With this, we have come to the end of our analysis session. The practice prelims question displayed here will be discussed in the next session. Moving on to the last session for the day, that is the practice questions discussion session. The first question is, consider the following statements with reference to the Institutions of Eminence scheme. Now here, the first statement is partially correct, as under this scheme, 10 public institutions are to be notified and identified to emerge as world-class teaching and research institutions. But along with 10 public institutions, 10 private institutions are also to be identified, not 5 institutions. So, as a whole, statement 1 is wrong. Here, the question asks for the correct statements. As statement 1 is wrong, option A and C can be eliminated. The second statement is correct. As under the scheme, the institutions of eminence will be provided financial assistance of up to rupees 1000 crore over a period of 5 years by the central government. And next, the third statement states that all institutes of Indian Institute of Technology have been granted the Institute of Eminence status, which is wrong because we saw that until now only 6 institutions have been granted the Institute of Eminence status, and under them 3 are public and 3 are private institutions, and only 2 IITs have been granted the status under public sector category, which are IIT Bombay and IIT Delhi. Hence, statement 3 is wrong. So, we can eliminate option D also. So, the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. The next question is, which among the following institutions of eminence have been listed under green field category? Now, for this question, try to remember that we discussed the term green field category. It means the institution has not yet been established. It is a separate category where the sponsoring organizations will set up new institutions. Under this category, the GA Institute will be set up by the Reliance Foundation. So, here the correct answer is option B, GA Institute of Reliance Foundation, which will be set up in Pune, Maharashtra. The next question is, consider the following statements. And we have to choose the correct statement from the given statements. Here the first statement is correct. Because while launching the target of the mission, it was kept as 20,000 megawatt or 20 gigawatt by 2022. But the target was later revised to 100 gigawatts, which makes the statement 1 as correct statement. And if you look at the second statement, it talks about the target set by government in renewable energy sector. And the statement has correctly given the targets such as 100 gigawatt for solar and 60 gigawatt for wind, 10 gigawatt for biopower and 5 gigawatt from small hydropower. Remember that you have to keep these numbers in memory because most probably these numbers will not change before 2021. So the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. The next question is, Press Freedom Index is released by which of the following organization? This is a very direct question. So the correct answer to this question is option B, Reporters Without Borders, which is also called as Reporters Sans Frontiers in French. Also try to know that Transparency International releases Global Corruption Perception Index, and International Press Institute and News Media Coalition are fewer other international journalism organizations. The next question is, consider the following statements with respect to the National Green Tribunal. Now, in this question, if you analyze, they have given two statements. Look at statement two. It says that the principal place of sitting of NGT is New Delhi. This statement will not create much disturbance in the examination hall. But look at statement one. Even though we may know that NGT has to deal with environment, such statements lead us to some confusion. Today we know that this statement is correct, as we have already discussed this in our analysis session. But if you want to remember this even after a year or some months, you have to clearly fix this statement in your mind. The statement is, NGT can take cases relating to enforcement of any legal right relating to environment, as this statement is a definite statement. And the statement does not say NGT can take cases relating to enforcement of some legal rights relating to environment. Therefore, whenever you study about an institution or anything, give importance to such definite and clear statements. So finally, the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Now let us see one mains question based on GS paper 2. In the World Press Freedom Index, India stands very low. Discuss briefly about the issues that impede the freedom of press and suggest some measures to improve the present condition. Now there are two statements in this question, so we can split this question into two. The first statement is a fact which speaks about India's rank in World Press Freedom Index. So discuss about the index, India's ranking in the index, and also about the comments on India. The statement asks to discuss about the issues that affect the press freedom and suggest some measures. Here you can include some of the present issues and laws that affect the freedom of press, which we have discussed in the editorial session. You can also use suggestions that we have discussed in the editorial to answer the second part of the statement. And also try to include your own appropriate points while answering the second statement. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on civil service examination preparation.